We're heading into a relatively significant El Nino phase, and what that means for fall, winter, next spring is going to be interesting here to bring us a lot of wet weather, especially across the south, and then stretching some wet weather from the southern plains through the central plains of the Great Lakes, where heat is versus cold is. What's most likely? Most likely is this scenario here. It does seem crazy, right? I mean, we're in the middle of summer. Wearing short sleeves and shorts, but we are in excessive heat. And when that happens, our kind of human nature is to think, ah, can't wait for winter. Can't wait to cool off. Can't wait for X, Y, and Z, whatever that may be, right? That's just human nature. So let's answer your curiosity and take a look at the outlook based on current projections for our El Nino coming our way. I pulled in the latest sea surface temperature data, satellite driven, and we can see here, painted on the map. Warmer than average ocean is painted in red and blue for colder than average oceans. One item of note that will be an impact on the cold season forecast is the amount of cold water that's left right in here. Right now off of North America's western coast, stretching out south of Hawaii. That'll be interesting to see play out. Another area of interest will be here in the Gulf of Alaska. That will also play into maybe the extent of Alberta clippers, for one example. So that's another area of ocean that will have an impact on this outlook. But we're kind of focusing here on the El Nino region, right? You've probably heard terms like the Super Nino or robust Nino coming our way. It likely will be a strong, perhaps significant El Nino, but as far as being historically strong, too early to call for that, and no forecast at the moment really truly calls for that. Some get close though. Here are our El Nino boxes where we look for those ocean conditions to be warmer or colder than average. Colder than average was a La Nina. Now that we're warmer than average in those boxes, we have a developed El Nino and it continues to strengthen. Here's the timeline. These are the boxes corresponding. So this box right here, that goes with this timeline from August of 2021, and then it goes to present day. And then on the far right, that's the 1.2 box, that's going to be down here. But in all timelines across all of these regions, we've seen the La Nina conditions, colder than average, subside. And most of that occurred earlier this year. We still had a strong Nina atmosphere in January, February, March, and then it weakened substantially. But now all those ocean basins are warm. And as you look over the past couple of months here, the trend is basically we've come very warm. In some cases, we're still warming, but we're kind of hitting that plateau right now. We're waiting on, say, some stronger winds, those trade winds, to become more favorable to enhance this current situation on the oceans. By changing the wind here, you begin to change how the ocean upwelling, those kind of things happen, and it will increase the temperatures in that basin. And as you increase the temperatures above where they are now, that's when you make for a stronger El Nino situation. If you look at just one region, the 3.4 region, if you read news headlines or listen to other weather sources, you're very likely coming out of that ocean box. That's the 3.4 ENSO region. If you look at that going back to 1950, right now, what does that represent? First, second, third, fourth place. In June, that region was the fourth strongest El Nino signature, if you will, for that particular region, historically for the month of June. Others were 87, 97, and 2015. Interesting years there, especially 2015 and 97. Those were very robust El Ninos by the following snow season, and they're analog years for this snow season. So with forecast numbers, I like the visual display from the Bureau of Meteorology in Australia. I like this. Right here, each column, we have different agencies. And down here on the bottom, this is our temperature anomalies, the temperatures of the ocean conditions, and it's in that same region, the 3.4 region. So, for example, Bureau of Meteorology from Australia, they're way up here for August, and they think we're going to be right around 2 degrees warmer than average. So, we're right around a degree C in that ENSO 3.4 region. They project another degree on top. Their projections have been a little bit on the hot side, a warm bias. One of the models that's actually been a bit more consistent and accurate has been NOAA's CFS forecast model. But you see a variety here, and then the average is down here at the very bottom. So we're looking at August. Let's go into September. Now we're above 1.6. Now we're nearing 2 degrees Celsius, warmer than average in that Niño 3.4 region. That's in October, November, and then December. Now we're climbing above 2 degrees. That's significant. That becomes historically significant. Assuming these model projections are accurate and that mean value is accurate, this would be roughly the fourth strongest El Niño in the oceans on record as we approach next snow season. And as I just mentioned, the CFS model has been kind of, it still has a warm bias, don't get me wrong, but it's continuously updated. So it kind of self-corrects. If it has a warm bias initially in a monthly projection, as a month goes on, it can kind of self-correct, if you get my meaning there. So let's just take that for an example. And it takes the current forecast as this black dashed line, some of the recent model runs are surrounding it. But as you go up here, it kind of clips. It stops at around 2, maybe 2.1. So it's just slightly below that model consensus, but still significant. It would be, say, since 1950, a top 5 event, even with a little bit of wiggle room on the accuracy of that CFS model. What has happened historically? For November through April, I'll call that the cold season or the snow season or winter, precipitation during strong El Niños. If you are into the light yellows, greens, blues, wetter than average. And look how much of the U.S. was wetter than average during those strong El Niños. And strength does matter. A weaker El Niño would take the surpluses and shrink them down and bring in the deficits and make them bigger deficits, especially up here in the Pacific Northwest, Northern Rockies, and out here in the Ohio Valley. A weaker El Niño would make those areas drier. Plus, as mentioned, we'd shrink down the wet areas. But that's not to say that all El Niños are the same. Let's look at three very strong El Niños and the breakdown of how they were different. As you can see, just visually, the three are very different. Let's take a closer look. 82 to 83, we had a lot of wet weather. Wettest to record wettest out around Sacramento and other parts of California, around Chicago. Then you have the lower Mississippi Valley from New Orleans up to Jackson. That was historically wet. Let's go to 97 and 98. Then you shifted those historic values to the east, all down the eastern seaboard, down into Florida, some pockets within Colorado, other areas out into California. Now let's go to 2015, 2016, and we shifted those historically wettest years into Wyoming, Nebraska, Iowa, around the Great Lakes, from St. Louis, down through the Osage country, into northern Texas. So again, the three strongest El Niños, none of them were identical. They all kind of had the same idea, though, and we want to keep Montana, the Northern Plains, dry. That was pretty consistent in these 2 years, not so much in the third. What are some other consistencies? Certainly having some moisture from Texas out to the southeast, that's consistent. Inconsistencies. What happens around the Great Lakes is different. What happens in the extreme Pacific Northwest is different based on different years of El Niño. And what's a factor here? I mean, what creates the differences, right? Well, we could have a different Atlantic regime. We could have a different Northern Pacific regime. That area of ocean around Alaska I showed you, that may not create an Alberta Clipper type winter for us versus another year which may have. So these are all possible differences within those three strongest El Niños. So it goes beyond what El Niño is doing to bring us a lot of wet weather, especially across the south, and then stretching some wet weather from the southern plains through the central plains of the Great Lakes. That's kind of what happens on average with a super strong El Niño event. And that's possibly, or likely, what we are headed into for next winter. We all have memories of El Niño events, right? I mean, for me, the early 80s stand out, and maybe the late 90s too, but it was the 82-83 event that sticks out in my mind. I was a little guy, I could remember digging through tunnels of snowfall in the El Niño that year in Colorado. It was remarkable. Let me know the year that sticks out in your mind. I'm a snow lover. I like talking about snow. I know a lot of you enjoy talking about snow too, so let's get to it. So in terms of snowfall with El Niño events, in January, February, March, are we likely to be more snowy or less snowy? That's this one. That's the anomalies map there. Above or below average snowfall. This is the frequency of getting that. So let me explain. So here, like around the Great Lakes, notice how those grab your attention. They represent a lot less snow versus a long-term average. So very low in the snow category. And is it frequent? It is very frequent. It happens a lot. So it's drier than normal here throughout the winter, less snow throughout the winter, and it is very frequent. Now, the opposite side of that would be, let's say the Texas Panhandle into Oklahoma, New Mexico into the Four Corners. On average, El Niño brings more snow to that area. And does that happen frequently? It does. It happens to be quite frequent that we'll have snowier winters. What's the difference here? Notice the eastern seaboard. They're also painted in these surpluses or snowy winters, but not all of them are frequent. It's a real hit and miss case for the East Coast on whether or not the snow is there or it's not. So basically, these two graphics are telling us with El Niño in place, we're very likely to have a low snow year for the upper Midwest and Great Lakes. It happens very frequently to be that way. On the other side of the coin, you flip it from the Four Corners into the Central and Southern Plains, on average, you get a lot more snow. And frequency, historically based, is there. So you're likely to have a snowier situation. But for the East Coast, it comes down to the ultimate setup. If the setup is perfect, you'll get a lot of snow. If the setup is not ideal, then you're frequently going to stay dry. So out of El Niño, the correlations are highest for a low snow year for the upper Midwest Great Lakes, better snow for the Rocky Mountains, the Four Corners, the Southern Plains, and then for the eastern seaboard, really comes down to some other ocean conditions. It can be interesting. In a lot of regions, we have El Niño favoring fall and spring, but maybe not the winter with a lot of snowfall. Or the opposite may occur. What it means for Colorado, El Niño versus La Niña, is written on weather5280.com. It's an older post. I need to update it, but it's still great information. So the atmosphere is a part of this as well. It's not just what the oceans are doing, because the oceans have to talk to the atmosphere above. If they're strongly coupled, then yes, this strong El Niño event will have a big impact on the country, and it likely will. But there are some periods historically where the atmosphere, shown here, kind of an atmospheric measure of the El Niño strength or La Niña strength, if the case may be, they don't always have to talk or go hand in hand. We likely will because of the bigger events like 82, 83, the atmosphere and the ocean strongly coupled, 97 to 98, and from 15 into 16, they worked strongly together. And since this event is likely leaning toward one of those stronger events, we likely will see that the atmosphere will chat with the ocean as it has historically. But that's still a question mark as far as the ultimate forecast. And if you think that may not matter, let me show you where it does matter. Based on the atmosphere and the strength of whether or not it's strongly El Niño or weakly El Niño, these are weak El Niño year temperatures, colder than average, hotter than average. This is strong El Niños, hotter than average, colder than average. Do you see a huge difference? I do too. So the atmospheric strength in terms of El Niño can make a very big difference on our temperatures during this cold season, during the winter. It can shift dramatically so where heat is versus cold is. What's most likely? Most likely is this scenario here. It kind of follows the recent trends, recent patterns. It follows more closely with the strong El Niño events. But if for some reason this event doesn't want to work hand in hand like those others, we may have a very flip-flop temperature pattern across the country for this cold season. And speaking of the atmosphere, currently it's bringing us a lot of heat, excessive heat across the southern tier of the U.S. Check out some of the most recent videos, the daily showers or the weather watches, and they discuss what the weather pattern is right now that's causing this heat dome to be so stagnant.